Stanley live this Tuesday in a night of kick-ass down and dirty rock and roll. Paul Stanley doing Kiss classics and new hits from his solo album. Paul Stanley this Tuesday with special guests Salty Dog and Mossy featuring Rhett Forrester, formerly of Riot. Tickets on sale now at the Palace Box Office. Call 213-462-6031, 462-6031, or any Ticketmaster outlet. And coming straight from the street to the Palace, it's Jet Boy, Friday, May 12th. Don't miss the final concert appearance of the infamous Paul Stanley with Salty Dog and Mossy this Tuesday, April 4th at the Palace in Hollywood. When you can rock at the Palace, why rock anywhere else?
Damn, that one had a beat on my face.
5 hours.
Yeah. And the thing is, you can't say what you say off the air.
No. Mm-mm.
I'm really excited because I have an incredible guest today.
An incredible guest.
Yeah, this man, I respect him greatly. And I'm really excited to meet him and talk to him. And
were you just going to tell us who he is?
Paul Stanley.
Oh, thank you.
Okay.
Ken, was that so difficult? Well, you know, women, you know, they just got to lead you on for like 10 or 15 minutes before they even, like, let on. When
it's called teasing.
It's called teasing. forget it.
I played it just for you. I can't get no satisfaction. Oh, and as I told you earlier, Paul Stanley was stopping by while I wasn't lying. I know it's hard to believe, but he is here, and we will talk with him in just a moment. But I want to also tell you before we go into these little pieces of business, that you have to get your KNACP rock card so that you can win stuff, right? Well, Paul Stanley, say hello to them. They don't believe me.
How? It's me.
It's me.
I drove myself here and everything.
Oh, no. What did you drive?
An automobile, of course.
What? Not
a bicycle.
A bicycle, right. You didn't take a Harley Davidson or...
No. I wanted something with a good radio and a good air conditioner.
Good. Yeah, so you know how to treat yourself in Los Angeles. Because you're not born here.
Well, you know, if I drive around on a Harley with my hair, it kind of like strangles me and stuff.
Yeah, boy, it's really gotten long, too.
Yeah, you know, it's those vitamins.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah.
You're looking fine. Paul Stanley, in fact, while we're on the physical subject, you've always been quite a fine specimen of physical health. What do you do? Do you work out on the road? Do you pump that iron, babe?
I pump that muscle, babe.
Seriously, I mean, let's see the muscles.
You've seen them. We know each other.
Yeah, we've been there. How about the tattoo? There was talk of... Is that the only tattoo you have?
You've seen the other.
Oh, no, will you stop?
Is that the only one?
And I don't know, is
it? Yeah, it's the only one. Yeah.
Okay, and you got that in San Francisco?
No, I got that here. I got that when we used to stay at the Riot House on Sunset. And across the street, the tattoo place became Cliff Raven. Before that, it was Lyle Tuttle.
Oh.
And while it was Lyle Tuttle, one day I was in the coffee shop, and I think I had like 10, 15 bucks in my pocket. And I said to the guys, I'll see you in a little while. And I came back with this rose on my shoulder. And it hasn't gone away since.
Yeah, impulsive.
I don't even have to water this thing.
It just stays alive there.
It's there.
Lyle Tuttle, of course, is a very famous... I mean, he did everybody John's job.
Oh, yeah. And I'm the only one left alive, I think.
Probably.
You get tattooed by him, you die.
You die. Now, what does that tell us? What is this Riot House you were referring to?
Well, the Continental Hyatt House, which is now called the Hyatt House or whatever it's called nowadays, they've kind of tried to tame it, you know, and tone it down a bit. That was the hotel where everybody used to stay. Zeppelin used to stay there, and there was... something was wrong if you didn't get banned from there, you know, so... Ultimately, we earned our stripes by getting thrown out. You know, I think we had a motorcycle in the hallway, and you know, just the usual. Had a good time.
You know, you seem like such a nice guy.
I am a nice guy.
Oh man, it's amazing to see Paul Stanley on stage. I was just raving after I saw your Celebrity Theater show.
Yeah.
What a treat it was to see you in a more intimate environment.
I think the funniest thing about doing it is that some people still don't know what to expect. Some people come and they think, you know, oh, you're doing a solo gig, you're going to come up with an acoustic guitar, you're going to play some songs about the environment. No. You know, it was just a great chance without having an album out or anything to put together a really great, great band and go out and play vintage Kiss stuff. We're doing things like Come On and Love Me and I Want You and I Stole Your Love and Love Gun and really like doing 17 songs. And the band sounds great.
God, it's a really healthy hour and a half.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's real good. I mean, when we walk off, we're sure satisfied. So far, nobody's asked for their money back either. But it's great, because usually when people go out and do this kind of stuff, they're either leaving a band or they're trying to sell a solo record. I have nothing to sell, folks. I'm just out there having a good time.
It's amazing. None of us could get that through our heads. We're all going, no, 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 there must be a solo record coming.
No, there's nothing, you know, and the guy, all the guys in Kiss have either shown up or are coming to the show in, you know, L.A., and then back to Kiss. But right now we're having a great time. The reviews have been great, which kind of makes me, kind of scares me a little, because I'm not used to getting reviews like that, you know?
Good reviews.
Yeah, it's like, what am I doing wrong?
But, oh, they're liking me now. Yeah. What's wrong?
But it's great. You saw the show.
Oh, man. It is so energetic. I mean, you're all over the place. We're going to talk a lot more about the show itself, get into some old history of Kiss. I want to play a song right now, one of the songs that you do in the early part of the set. Come on and love me. Okay?
Anything for you, babe.
I'm in control. I love it.
No, you're not.
You're Rock. KNAC, Paul Stanley here, and a kiss. KNAC, Pure Rock, come on and love me, Kiss, dressed to kill. God, that goes back a few, huh?
Yeah.
Brings back a memory or two.
Uh-huh. And for you too, huh?
Yeah, I'm afraid it does.
For all you people who are listening, you're turning like this great red that matches the chair.
Am I really?
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
Blushing. It's not easy to get me to blush either, and I just wish you would stop it, Paul.
This is getting better and better.
He's loving this. He's loving torturing me like this. Let's talk about let's talk about your film career for a moment, shall we?
Which one? The one that people see or the one I have at home?
Well, I haven't seen the one you've had at home, so why don't we talk
about
it?
You're in it, babe.
Yeah, right. I know I'm in Decline in Western Civilization in the middle years with you.
Yeah, you're under the sheet.
Yeah, that was me squirming around down there.
That's not all me.
But actually, it was interesting seeing you in that setting. I know that Penelope Spheris, the director, said anyone could be in whatever setting they wanted, and you chose this really pretty penthouse-y kind of thing.
Yeah, it's real funny, because sometimes people say, you know, come on, you know, enough with the women and this and that. Yeah, I mean, really, what could be more fun and what could be better than being in bed with a bunch of good-looking women? And, hey, if you can think of something better, if you'd rather, you know, be shot sitting on a Harley, more power to you.
But, hey, you know, I was thinking, in a way, you were almost doing it just out of fun, too, in a kind of a joking sense, because you are a sex symbol. And I think that maybe you don't feel...
Well, I mean, it's a joke, you know. I mean, I don't take any of this seriously. So anybody who really thinks that I'm really serious about being in bed with all these women, I mean, I'm real thankful that I can do it. But hell, it's like, you know, I was the guy who got turned down in school for all the dates. And
oh, come on. Really?
It's a sad story, folks. Get out your violins and plug it into the Marshall.
Yeah, right. No, really, was it a rough time in school?
Yeah, it was rough.
Oh,
it was real tough.
I have trouble believing this. At any rate, how about your first high school memories of your first song that you ever heard on the radio?
Well, first song I heard on the radio was long before high school. When I was like 6 years old, I used to listen to American Bandstand, because that was on, and all the kids in my neighborhood were out playing with guns and real guns. I grew up in New York.
Real guns.
And I was just sitting in my house, you know, listening to American Bandstand, listening to rock and roll, and thinking that's really what I want to do. Everybody else was plotting their course to become doctors and lawyers, and I was trying to be, you know, Eddie Cochran or somebody like that.
So very clearly, at the
age of... Not Eddie Cochran. Eddie Cochran.
Quite a difference.
Quite a difference.
So you're actually at 6 years of age, pretty much had your...
all I wanted to be when I grew up was 16.
Yeah.
You know, that seemed ambitious enough.
Oh, man, that's true. How about your first band? What was the situation?
I hadn't been in many bands. I think Kiss was probably the second band. First band I was in, basically I used to listen to a lot of English music on the radio, and a lot of the stuff I couldn't afford because they were all import albums. So what I did was I wound up writing my own songs that sounded like them.
Oh.
So I would just steal ideas from here and there and write songs, you know, kind of like the way I remembered what I'd heard on the radio. Because in New York we had Scott Muni, and he had like the English Hour.
The disc jockey.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you'd listen to that and hear what the top 10 was in England. And it was always real interesting because there was a lot of stuff that never made it in America. So, I mean... You were listening to The Pretty Things and The Move, you know, and Kinks and Yardbirds and all that stuff. And then I'd go into my room and try to rewrite those songs.
And, of course, they say, a lot of those people anyway, like the Yardbirds, say that they got their influences from the old black blues.
Yeah. Well.
Going back to the States.
That's right. Well,
it's all sick, isn't it?
Uh-huh. It's very incestuous.
Incestuous, that's indeed.
Right. Yes.
And do you have still your first song that you ever wrote on paper?
first song I wrote, my first guitar lesson, someone tried to teach me, down in the valley. So
valley
I decided,
in the
yeah,
valley.
So I wrote a socio-political song, which would probably do very well on a U2 album nowadays, but for me it was, no. I remember it, but it's one that will remain unquoted.
Well, maybe at another time.
Yes.
We'll save that for later. You got to save something for later. In fact, later, tomorrow, as a matter of fact, Paul Stanley's last show of this tour.
Yeah.
It's happening at the Palace.
As opposed to the last show of my career. Paul Stanley's last show is tomorrow night, folks.
No, it's going to be incredible. You've got to go. I think Ticketmaster has the tickets.
I don't know.
That venue.
I don't know, but if you don't get any, I'll be out front selling whatever I have
for you. Oh, you're going to miss it if you don't go. It's going to be quite magical. And the good thing, if you've been to the Palace before, you know that the sound system isn't that appropriate for the rock and roll sound, but...
I brought in my own. I've been traveling with my own PA, my own monitors. I've been bringing the sound guy who does us and used to do Aerosmith and worked with like every big band around. Because I wanted to go play clubs, but I didn't want to sound like a club band.
Yeah, right.
So it's top notch. I mean, I'm real proud of this.
And it's unreal. The sound quality is just. You should be proud.
Yeah, and the band's really just serious kick ass band.
Let's give them a plug.
Great drummer, Eric Singer, who's playing with Jakey Lee.
Yeah.
And used to play with Gary Moore and played in Black Sabbath. He's just a phenomenal drummer. And Bob Kulick's playing guitar.
Who's the brother
of
Bruce?
He's the brother of Bruce Kulick. And Bob's got a mustache and Bruce doesn't.
And Bob Bruce, has no hair and Bruce
And Bruce does. And Dennis St. James is on bass and singing, and he's played with Michael Schenker and with Heaven. And the keyboard player, Gary Corbett, played with Lou Graham. And it's just a great band. I mean, it's major. I'll put it up against anything that's out there. On a bad night, we're pretty good.
Damn right. In fact, I know that Gary Corbett has done your European tour with Kiss.
Yeah, he's played with Kiss.
You're still with Kiss. Let's not make that mistake.
Yeah, I saw an ad in the paper in one city where it said, Paul Stanley, formerly of
Kiss.
Oh, my God.
The rumor
I'm out. They didn't even tell me.
I could break a guy's heart. We should play some more music. What do you think?
Hey, it's a lot more interesting than me talking.
Oh, no, that's not true. But you know, when you asked about an encore song,
right.
I was shouting Love Gun at the top of my lungs. And, of course, that's I don't want to give it all away as to what you do on the whole show. But I was glad that you played that. So I'm going to just play it here. What do you think?
It's great. It gives us a few minutes to get to know each other.
Yeah. Don't we sound like we're old friends or something? People would sound, they're already putting us together as a couple. I can't believe it. It's number 6 on the Love Gun title track there.
Okay.
On Pure Rock KNAC. Paul Stanley live in the studio. And we're freaking here. KNAC, Pure Rock, Love Gun. Paul Stanley and I will be... right back. We're not really going anywhere. We're just going to pay the bills. Okay,
Just getting down.
Welcome back from spring break.
Back, all right. We are having fun. By the way, I should tell you what Paul Stanley's wearing. Paul said that he was poolside when he decided it was time to come and do a little interview with me. And he's got these bitchin' sunglasses. They're blue. They make me look like my and I look into them. I feel like I'm underwater because they're so blue. And you got this Naval Station San Diego hat. Who gave you that?
Somebody gave it to me at one of the shows. And told me that it had gone to, like, Malaysia with them or something. So I said, cool.
Hey, worldwide.
I'll wear it.
And this old jacket it is, isn't it? Jean jacket that's so faded and ripped up.
This is the real thing. This is from a thrift shop.
It's so cool.
You know, I mean, hey, you can see. Folks, you can't see this at home.
But it's actually got this old patch on the back, and it's ripped, and it's great, and it was embroidered swim trunks.
Yeah,
and
we can talk about what you're wearing, because you're wearing a skirt, and I'm on the right side of it.
He's such a kidder, this boy, I tell you.
I'm not kidding.
We've got a... I've changed the subject.
There goes that color again.
I swear to God. We have some solo stuff that we're going to get to, because you do like to play your solo album, and you're proud of it. In fact, I know that when Kiss, each member,
right.
back in the days when you put this out... when you did this, there were 1 million copies of each album released.
Yeah.
On the same day.
Yeah.
Total of 4 million copies.
Yeah, I've got about 500,000 in my garage.
You want to buy
one? You want to buy one?
Man, that was quite sad. That was the only time that's ever happened.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the cool thing is that with Kiss, we've always wanted four members to be real important. And obviously, in most bands, you don't want to hear a solo record from the drummer. Well, you don't want to hear a solo record from the guy who you don't know who he is or what he plays, who's on the left side of the stage. But with KISS, I mean, we've always tried to keep everybody real important. And it was just a great way for us all to let off some steam. Because things were going, I mean, you know, literally we went from being this band that couldn't find a gig in New York to suddenly playing stadiums.
And packing them to the rafters.
So it was pretty wild. And at some point, when we were turning out like 2 albums a year, we just said, you know, let's cool out for a while, get away from each other, and do these records. And we had a lot of fun doing them. And then we kind of all got together and we played each other the record. This is what I did. You know, it was kind of like how I spent my summer vacation.
Yeah, right. So was there a vote as to who liked which one best? Or, of course, did you each like your
own? I'm sure everybody was very fond of their own album.
Yes, Rava. Yeah. Now, as far as the actual, you produce a little, don't you? I mean, I know that you produce KISS products, but do you produce other artists as well?
I'm in the studio this month doing some of Cher's album.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
And there's other stuff coming up.
I heard you were going to work with Poison at one point.
Well, that didn't, actually it was on for this album that's out now. What was happening was they were flying me out to see them, and we spent some time together, and I think what happened was the last album theirs kept going on the charts and had much longer life than was expected, and by the time we finished Crazy Nights and had to go out on tour, they were getting ready to go in and do it. So at that point, there wasn't much sense to do anything except wish each other luck and go bowling. And that's what we did.
Are you going to then go in the studio shortly with the new KISS product?
Yeah. We'll be in the studio June 1st.
Wow.
And it's funny because we're real excited. I think one of the great things about going out and doing these club shows is it kind of gave me more of a feel for what people really want to hear from us. And, you know, the old stuff just seems to go over so great that all the new stuff for the next album sounds really like the old stuff.
Got that feel.
Yeah, I mean, it's real rock and roll. It's heavy, but it's much more rock and roll. It's more like Come On and Love Me and stuff like that. It's all guitars, and it's really cool because it's kind of like going backwards, but hey, I've bumped into some pretty good things going backwards.
Yeah, right, and we've been talking about cycles anyway. I mean, you guys have been around quite some time. So it makes sense to me. It was good to have the latest hits album come out and then have that, let's put the X in Sex
right.
for a little twist.
Yeah.
You wrote that with?
I wrote, X in Sex was Desmond.
Desmond Child.
And I think Diane may have written on that, from Diane Warren. Those two people write so many hits I can't keep up with them. But they are Billboard Magazine.
Yeah,
I think they wrote that with me.
That's a fun tune. And now, as far as back to the film thing, I understand you're going to put out a new. Is that something I can talk about? You look like you're going to stop me.
No, I'm just thinking. Go ahead.
You're thinking with your mouth open.
Yeah.
You're going to put out another home video.
Yeah, we'll put out.
89.
Yeah, I guess we'll put out KISS Exposed 2 sometime this year, because we've got like so much footage. We literally have about 40 concerts, 40 or 50 concerts, start to finish on tape. And there's like a complete library of like all the news clips that we've had and anything that's been on television, you know, that we've done. 11 o'clock news, anything like that.
So you're not just picking up from where you left off with KISS Exposed.
Well, yeah,
right?
Actually it's going to be a continuation of that because that, I mean, it was a huge success.
It's hysterical.
Yeah, well, you know.
It's really funny, and the guy, the host, is really funny.
Yeah,
so
he's pretty funny. Mark Blankfield. But we had a great time making it, and everybody seemed to like it. And kind of like a live, you know, like the live albums, people keep saying, when are you going to come out with Exposed 2? So we've got all the footage and everything, and once we finish the next album, I guess we'll do Exposed 2, and then we hit the road.
I see. Now, as far as when this Exposed 2 actually goes into production, are you going to do the same kind of thing as far as having a host, or is it going to be something a little different? Will you host?
Don't have
show?
A clue.
Oh, okay.
Don't have a clue.
You're a good interviewer. You could actually, you and Gene could host it easily enough, the whole thing.
Well, thank you.
Well, thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
We'll see.
Yeah, I mean, my problem is you put a microphone in front of me and all I do is just mouth off, you know.
That's the idea.
Yeah, I know.
That's what microphones are for.
Is that so? No, you look very nice with one in front of you.
Thank you so much. Yeah. On that note, darling, let's put one record on here.
Yes.
And check it out. This is the solo release that we were talking about, Paul Stanley's anyway. And this song Paul picked for himself to play to for you. What song? I mean, want to tell us the story behind it?
Once Upon a Time.
Once Upon a Time.
This is actually it's the first song on my solo record. This came out, I guess, what, 1978, 1979, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one of those cool songs from my solo record that I play live.
And here it is on Pure Rock, KNAC, Paul Stanley. Yeah, you're not a romantic at all, are you? Paul Stanley.
Yeah.
He's here in the studio live in case you just tuned in. You've been missing out.
Are we going to give away tickets?
Yeah, we better do it before I forget again, huh? We're talking tickets for the show tomorrow night at the beautiful Palace. It's going to be an incredible evening. I know, what does it start at? 8 o'clock? Let's see. Yeah, 8:30. Who goes on before you at this show? Do you know?
No, I don't have a clue.
It's been different bands.
Yeah, but I'm sure they're well worth showing up to see, folks.
That's right.
Support the local bands.
That is
because sooner or later, they're going to move on to bigger and better things, and you can say you saw them when.
Just like Kiss did. In fact, that's the question that we're going to ask you. If you can answer this question, we have three pairs of tickets to the first three correct answers at 213-437-KNAC or 714-534-KNAC.
Look how the phone suddenly lit up. Is that
wild? They're
going
wild. The question is, what was the name of Kiss?
Yeah, before we turned into Kiss, we had a different name.
Yeah, so what was it, kiddo? Come on, give us a buzz. I know you know. You guys, these are smart people. They know their stuff.
Anybody who listens to this kind of music is smart.
That's
smarter
true.
Than anybody else knows.
That's why we're sly as a fox. All right, we'll be right back. Paul Stanley and I, don't go away.
And call 1-800-382-0700 now.
I was just quizzing Paul Stanley on how many records Kiss actually has out, and he's going, I think 23.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
It's hard to keep track after a while.
Yeah, after the first 20, you know.
And then it just kind of...
Yeah, I think it's about like 22, 23, something like that.
How many platinum albums?
I think 17 or 18 are like multi, and then, so I guess like, I think 17 of them are like multi-platinum.
My Lord have mercy. How many, you guys have done a lot of things with marketing to make your fans happy, actually. You put things out like Kiss dolls and the comic strip.
Yeah, it's real funny because when we started doing that, there was like this tremendous backlash against it because people were saying, you're a rock and roll band and rock and roll has nothing to do with merchandise and marketing. And if you were a real rock and roll band, you wouldn't be doing that. And we always were figuring that our job was to give the people what they wanted. And if people want a belt buckle or a t-shirt with your name on it, you should be proud enough to have them want to wear it that you give it to them. So we started doing all that merchandising, and lo and behold, all of a sudden every band had a fan club. And nowadays you can see your favorite singer plugging Michelob on TV, and I'm still like, scratching my head, but I guess when you lead the parade, you got to take the lumps.
I guess so. Well, you put out some very strange things too, like trash cans.
Yeah, we put out trash cans. We put out sleeping bags. I was partial to the sleeping bag, actually.
That's a great one. Yeah. What else can you think of?
Lunch boxes.
Uh-huh.
The dolls.
Oh, to get one of those for Long Paul. He's missing out.
Pencils and ice cream. And
oh, makeup, too.
Yeah, makeup. And
my God, ice cream.
Yeah, edible panties. No.
No, just kidding.
No, just joking. Everything. I mean, it was wild. There was so much stuff. Pajamas, all that kind of stuff.
Did you actually have your own company that put all this stuff out? Or?
No. You know, companies would come to you and say, hey, can we use your name and this and that? And, you'd just make sure that everything was fair. I mean, you figure, you know, really, if somebody's going to put something out and it's going to have your name on it, you should have control of it. You should make sure that the quality's good. And they shouldn't be ripping you off.
Right.
So, you know, some people would say, well, you know, you guys know too much about business. Well, you know, I don't think there's anything romantic or exceptionally cool about being broke, you know. And to me, that's just stupidity. So if somebody just wants to sit around and play a guitar and leave it to somebody else to take care of their expenses, I think somewhere down the line they're going to realize that thing moving around in their pants was this other guy's hand pulling the money.
Yeah, it's a good attitude, actually. And I think that with a lot of aspiring musicians in this town listening right now, for them to be aware and very wise and keep up with the business end of things, that's good advice.
Yeah, nobody does anything for nothing. So when somebody's helping you out, there's something in it for them.
And don't be fooled.
Yeah, so somebody's sitting around going, I just want to make music. Well, you're setting yourself up. You might as well wear a sucker on the back of your jacket.
Sucker, nice big sign. Let's go back to the early concepts, the conceptualization of Kiss. You and Gene, obviously, right, are the the original team?
Well, we were together before Kiss, yeah.
And how did it come with the makeup and the shoes and the clothing?
I think we just wanted to, you know, we wanted to be the band we never saw. You know, we were really into, like, English bands, and we were really into, like, the bands that had something to offer other than music. There were a lot of bands around that did some pretty good music, but were awful looking. Then there were some bands around that looked pretty good that sounded awful. So we just figured, you know, we were basically in the audience. We figured, let's go up on stage, throw them off, and see what we can do.
And blow some minds.
Yeah, so what we did is kind of became the band that we wanted to see.
So you sat and sort of really thought about this and decided the makeup thing, or did things progress?
It kind of just evolved. It wasn't like us sitting around with this, what they do. They have these marketing strategies at these big companies where everybody throws around ideas. Really, it was like you'd walk into, we had a loft, which is basically just a small room in a building in New York, and that's where we rehearsed, and we would come in, and someone might be sitting in front of a mirror putting on makeup, or someone else might be in there drawing, you know, and it was really interesting, because at that point, we would come in every day and write songs, and, I mean, we wrote, probably in a week's time, we probably wrote Black Diamond, Strutter, Nothing to Lose, you know, Firehouse. Right. Firehouse I wrote when I was in high school, but most of that stuff was just, we were just churning it out. We knew what we wanted to do. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, but damn. How about the actual costuming parts? Did you ever have any kind of clothing designer work with you on that
stuff?
No.
That's
wild. Creation.
In the beginning, it was wild because when we used to get, you know, all that studded stuff, all the leather and studded stuff that, you know, later became, I guess, stuff you could buy at Kmart. We used to get it. The collars came from pet shops. I mean,
sure.
We would get the studded collars. I mean, they belonged on Rin Tin Tin, but we would get them big enough to wear. And then we go to, like, these, on the west side of New York, all the way over near the docks, are where there's these little strange places where they make a lot of S&M gear. And we used to go there, and they used to make our clothes for us. And they used to, you know, the fittings for the pants took the longest. I don't know why. They just couldn't seem to get them right. But, so we used to go to all these places, and they make all that stuff for us. So, I mean, really, it just came out of an idea that we had, you know.
Seeing how you move now on stage, I was trying to visualize how you could even stand on those shoes that you guys used to wear. I mean, how many inches were they? 12-inch heels or something? I mean,
yeah, they were real big.
They were hard to move around, and I would think.
Yeah.
What kind of shoes do you wear now?
I don't know.
Let's see. Why, they're tennies. No, I mean, really, to move around, you have to be comfortable, and yet
but we used to, I mean, even with those heels and everything, we used to run around the stage. I mean, you reach a point where you're probably faster on those things than most people are in, you know, like tennies or something.
Yeah,
it reached a point where, I mean, we were running up and down flights of stairs on stage, you know.
And how about the explosives? Anybody ever get any close calls?
Yeah, you know, you had your, you know, your like eyebrows singed once in a while and things. It's pretty, you learn to respect that stuff real quick when you get too close to it.
You sure do.
Yeah.
It's always been fascinating to see Gene Simmons swallowing the fire. What is that liquid that you put in your mouth to swallow fire, but to spit it out?
Yeah. Well, if I told everybody, then everybody's going to go into the store, and we're going to have reports tomorrow of people's heads blowing up.
You know? No, you don't dare give out. Yeah. Yeah, don't practice this at home.
Yeah, don't do this, you know.
It's just something that you can buy at a magic shop, or what?
No. It's something much more common.
Probably tastes awful, right?
Well, you know, I mean, from the first day that he's done that, you know, when we first started, we called in a magician, and we wanted to get some cool tricks, you know, stuff to do. So this guy walked into our office and said, you know, you can breathe fire. And he, like, filled his mouth with the stuff and shot out this flame. And he said, who wants to do it? And I just not me, pal. You
know. Gene volunteered.
Oh, absolutely.
That's too
absolutely.
Funny.
Gene had no problem with that. I said, I'll just shake my butt. He can breathe the fire.
I love it. Amazing. I think we have our three winners. We should give them, you know, the answer of the name of the band before it actually was Kiss.
Yes, it was called The Beatles.
The Beatles.
It was called Wicked Lester.
That's Lester.
Right. Yeah.
Absolutely. Was that your second band that you were in?
Yeah, actually. I don't think I was in one band before that kind of like evolved into, I don't know what it evolved into, a breakup. And then I think I met Gene. I only did like one or two shows live before Kiss got together. I'd never played in front of people.
Oh, man. And you weren't shy at all, were you? Go ahead, Jay. Bring that on in here. We want to congratulate these winners for knowing this. These are smart people. Andrea Westchester, Edgar Bravo, and Martin Gracias, I think it is. Your penmanship sucks. I'm sorry, Jay. This is terrible. But anyway, we do have our winners, and congratulations. It's Pure Rock 105.5 KNAC, Long Beach, Los Angeles.
Look how those phones light up. That's amazing.
Yeah, they like the station, honey.
I'm sure. Well, because they can only see you.
Oh. We'll be out at the Palace tomorrow.
Well.
Okay.
If you look anything like you do now, I'll be, actually, there'll be a lot of competition between you and me.
Yeah, really, we do dress alike, don't we?
Well, I think my chest may be hairier, but yours may be more interesting.
I don't know about that. It depends on a man's point of view or a woman's point of view.
Mine does nothing for me. I got news for you.
A man who's so kind and so flattering. We have to go on to a song here. Because I figure we should... Oh, I know it was. Heaven's on Fire.
Okay.
I was commenting on how amazing it is that... Still hits those notes still, remember, after all these years. No, I mean, actually, to be honest with you, it's not a studio trick. It's his real voice. Check this out. On Pure Rock, KNAC. Heaven's on Fire. You know, truly, every single thing that you hear on that record, you hear on that stage. And
that's right, because it's the same tape.
Yeah, right. He brought his records with him. Paul Stanley in the studio in the Getting Off Hour of KNAC. I'm Todd Mastery. We've had the most wonderful conversation. One other quickie here. As far as unveiling the makeup, was that a very daring move?
It's always like no guts, no glory. You know, I mean... If you take big chances, that's the only way you get anything, you know. If you, like, hold on to the past, or if you hold on to something because you're afraid of what lies ahead, then you're stuck, you know. I'd rather get rid of the rearview mirror and just keep going forward. And it either works or it doesn't. If it doesn't work, then it wasn't meant to. And if all you are is, like, a band with a lot of smoke machines and makeup, then you should have your day and go home,
mm-hmm.
You know. I mean, we're still... I mean, the next tour will be great, and it'll be big, big show and everything, but I don't want to be a prisoner to something that I created. You know, I mean, we feel real strong about what we do, and if it's just a matter of making money by, you know, living in the past, I'm not interested. None of us are. You know, I mean, nobody's forced to come see us. Nobody's forced to come see me. Nobody's forced to buy our records, but we sleep real well at night knowing we do what we want.
Yeah, well, here, bravo to you. Don't miss the show tomorrow night at the Palace. Paul Stanley's last of a tour of about 24 dates or so.
Yeah.
It was a real treat to be able to see this happen, and I can't wait for the next Kiss project. We'll be there for you.
Great. I'll see you, and I'll be there tomorrow night, and so will you.
Yes, my darling. Thanks again for coming here to KNAC.
Anytime.
It was all too kind of you. Here's a tune. We'll find out tomorrow if he does it or not on stage. I'm Pure Rock, KNAC. Yes.
Detroit, a Pontiac, Michigan youth was reported dead at the scene of a head-on collision on Grand Avenue this morning. The youth was reported to drive into the wrong side of the boulevard when he struck a delivery truck and was catapulted through the windshield of his car. The driver of the truck is reported to be uninjured. The identities of both men are being held by local police. County legislators today are expected to rally to the aid of striking longshoremen's hopes of ending the 9-month deadlock.
Said, the act we see today called Kiss was the concept of that meeting between Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley, but Gene hasn't always been into rock and roll.
I was responsible enough to go through high school, then college, and then I started teaching sixth grade, and that lasted for about 6 months, during which time I wanted to wring every one of those little necks.
This is in New York City?
Yeah. It was not an easy place. It was Spanish Harlem. You know, all the little ones that come from broken homes, and if they didn't have authority figures at home, certainly they wouldn't react to authority figures in school. school. So it really wasn't their fault. It was mine. I think that I became a teacher for the wrong reason, and I found out only later. You see, no matter how well the lesson went, and didn't matter how well I taught it, nobody clapped at the end of the day. You know,
you wanted some.
Yeah, I want. I want to know how well I've done. And certainly teaching is a performance. You've got to, not only have you got to give the information, but to make it interesting, you've got to use hand gestures and use analogies and say it's a performance. And you're on stage, you're much higher than anybody, everybody's sitting. There's a beginning of the show, okay, time for the show to begin, and it lasts an hour, or however long the session lasted, but it just, you walk through the hallway and everybody knows who you are, you're famous, so there goes Mr. So-and-so, he's the so-and-so teacher, but it just wasn't enough.
You identify with Welcome Back, Carter, on television?
Oh, quite a bit, sure.
To a rock audience who've heard Led Zeppelin and seen ELO's laser effects, where does Kiss score in a rock act? Paul Stanley.
Well, the difference, I think, between us and most other bands that may have had some kind of show is that the show is part of what we are, whereas perhaps most bands build a show to accompany the group. Our show doesn't accompany the group. We are the show. And everything going on around us is just embellishing us.
Ace Frehley explains.
Every tour just got more elaborate because, we were known for a theatrical rock show. And it seemed like every time we went out on tour in the States, we had to top the last show. So we had to get, the stage had to get bigger and the effects had to get bigger. And we had to invest more money, and we ended up every tour adding another 18-wheeler, semi-truck, to trailer. It just got crazy. Here we have 13 trucks. I mean, it's just insane. I use about 10 less poles to this job. Each one has a different function. You'll see when the show, one shoots rockets, one explodes, one goes into, one smokes, one has the lights chasing across it. It's a circus,
Well, one single feature which basically identifies Kiss and distinguishes them from any other rock group you might meet is the makeup. Eric Carr.
There's a lot of preparation that goes into it, I think there's a real change in everybody when they get into character, which is really remarkable. I mean, I've only been doing it a short time, and I even feel it happening to me now, and I see it happening to Gene, Paul, and Ace. It's like Ace said, being an actor, any kind of a performer, when you get into your role, you get into the part that you're playing, But this is a little bit beyond that because it's part of everybody's personality and their own characters. So it makes it that much easier for it to come out on stage. So actually what we're doing on stage is just living out parts of our personality.
I don't want to add to that. As I said before, the four of us, the original four, designed their own makeup. And believe it or not, Eric came up with his own outfit.
No, believe it or not.
A lot of people, when we realized Peter was leaving to go off on his own career, we were saying, Jesus, we need a replacement. What's he going to be? Because he can't be a cat, because Peter was a cat. You have to get a totally new character. And, I was sitting there at the meeting with Bill O'Coin and the rest of the guys, and I said, I have a strange feeling that the guy we find is going to come up with his own makeup and his own character. He's gonna, because that's just the vibe I got. It'll be fate. And it happened. He came up with the fox, the idea, then he designed the makeup, and he designed his costume. It was fabulous. Well, I've maintained the same characters. I've always played the role of the spaceman. Gene has always been the demon, the monster, And the costumes have changed in variation, but still kept the same concept. me.
So, why did KISS succeed, combining rock and theater, when other groups like The Tubes failed?
I've seen The Tubes many times. I know the guys real well. Well, they've dropped a lot of the theater now. Yeah, because it hasn't been working. You have to realize after a certain point.
Well, what does KISS work? Yep.
I think that you can't ever make fun of yourself. I think that if you're an actor in a movie or a clown in a circus or a prime minister or anybody that does anything, you can't ever make fun of yourselves, because then you ruin the credibility of your own character. If a stripper comes out on stage and she's dressed for a part and she's going to act a certain way, if she comes out and she's self-conscious about what she's doing, then her whole thing is not sexy. She's got to be, and you can't giggle and say, oh, look how silly this looks. You know, you can't make fun of yourself. You have to be authentic and honest. And I think The Tubes were a great tongue-in-cheek parody of a theatrical band. That's why I don't think anybody ever took it seriously. If I get up on stage and I'm uncomfortable in who I am, if I feel awkward, the audience picks that up in a second, in a snap. You can sense, you know, and the way animals can sense fear, it's the same thing. You can stare a lion down. He will not attack you if you've got eye contact and you give him, you know. You can stare a lion down. He will not attack you if you've got eye contact and you give him, you know, this complete confidence stare. Cats will back off from that.
But the rock act and the music is only a part of the KISS empire. They cater to their fans better than any other organization, with the possible exception of the Catholic Church. There are KISS dolls, KISS badges, ice cream, bubblegum, t-shirts, makeup kits, and school bags. 4 years ago, the group could easily have retired for life on the proceeds. Hayes Fraley explains.
The merchandising industry developed because there were so many people ripping us off in the United States, you know, because we're such a visual act, obviously. You know, we lend ourselves to merchandising. There were so many people putting out merchandising, a lot of it was garbage. So we decided that we would put out our own merchandising and control it because we didn't want the kids getting ripped.